There's the Paramount logo. Now known as the old Paramount logo. Right? Cue up, everyone. We're about to begin. Jerry Goldsmith. God bless his soul. Beautiful horns. A theme not unlike Air Force One, you'll find. Chadich. Ah, my Amzari Mina. My godmother. More on that to come, Alfre Woodard. The wonderful vegan talent, James Cromwell. Alice Krieger, perhaps the sexiest villainess ever in Star Trek history. Genius. John Knoll, creator of Photoshop. See, you'll get all kinds of facts today. Deborah Everton, I used her again on Clock Stoppers. Great costume designer. He's still cut on film. No Avid on the first Star Trek movie that I did. Herman Zimmerman, the designer of all things Star Trek. And my big brother, Matt Leonetti. Marty Hornstein, crunching the numbers. Gene. My patron and friend, Rick Berman. Always good to take a story credit and get that extra paycheck. A roar of the crowd. Great shot. Great shot. Professor Sid Dutton from Illusion Arts and Bill, his sidekick. We talked about, as an inspiration for this, the Sweeney Todd, which was, when it was produced in New York, the set went all the way out and wrapped around the theater so that you felt that you were inside this factory. Great use of handheld, undercranked, wide angle. Everybody likes Patrick as Locutus. Find the lens, there we go. Is futile. Ooh, ooh, watch this. Oh! That'll wake you up. He says so much with so little, Patrick. Great effect. ILM. This is the last film that ILM did of the Star Trek, of the Star Treks, which they had a patent on for ages. You see the set deck around Patrick's set, all sort of hand-picked by he and Herman to reflect what they both felt Picard would have taken with him on board the ship. On board the ship, some Shakespeare stuff, some memorabilia from planets that the character has visited.
6 years has finally arrived. The Borg, our most lethal enemy, have begun an invasion of the Federation. And this time there may be no stopping them.
This was the first film that all of the ships were completely computer generated. Up to generations, certain ships were still black models on sticks run in front of a Dubatin. Good looking actor there with the beard.
In case the Romulans decide to take advantage of the situation.
The Romulans?
Captain, there has been no unusual activity along the Romulan border.
The requisite scene in the...
It seems highly unlikely they would choose this moment to start a conflict.
Does Starfleet feel we need more shakedown time?
Captain, we've been out in space nearly a year now. We're ready. The Enterprise E is the most advanced starship in the fleet. We should...
LeVar Burton lobbied for years to get the headband taken off his eyes so that we could see his wonderful expressive eyes, and he finally won the battle here. To all of our... Set a course for the neutral zone. I've done that before! Riker always with the lean. I always found something to lean on. Here we go into the neutral zone. Anything could happen now. Another one of Picard's favorite pastimes. Loud, bad opera. Never before done. Reflection in the mirror. Oh, what a clever director.
Bizet?
Berlioz.
Yes.
What do you have?
We finished our first sensor sweep of the neutral zone.
The alliteration. Not lost on us. Bizet? Berlioz, you idiot number one.
52 ultraviolet radiation spikes and a class 2 comet. Wow.
Always good with exposition, Patrick. Give it to Patrick or LeVar or Brent. Keep it away from me and Marina. Technobabble and exposition.
Every confidence in the Enterprise and her crew, they're just not sure about her captain. They believe that a man who was once captured and assimilated by the Borg should not be put in a situation where he would face them again. To do so would introduce an unstable...
A lot of product in that Riker's hair, isn't there? No shortage of mousse. You tell him, Riker.
Hayes disagrees.
Bridge to Captain Picard.
Go ahead.
We've just received word from the fleet. They've engaged the Borg.
Music cue. Obviously a good place for a music cue. Big wide-angle sweeping shot. Rint introduced the brand-new bridge, which is gorgeous, I must say. This guy down here, camera left, Neil McDonough, star of a big TV series now.
A Borg cube on course 0, mark 215. Speed warp 9.
We are the Borg. Lower your shields and surrender your ships. We will add your biological and technological distinctiveness to our own. Your culture will adapt to service us.
Leonetti. Wonderful sense of being inside the head with the camera movement to that.
Mr. Hawk, pursued course.
Engage. A hand motion Patrick probably regrets choosing. Mr. Picard, do engage for us. That's him at the conventions. Mr. Stewart, give us a couple of engages, please, Mr. Stewart.
Welcome aboard the Enterprise, Mr.
Ward. Yes.
The Defiant.
Poor Michael Dorn, always in the makeup trailer before any of us. Sitting there an hour ahead of everyone else, getting the turtle glued onto his head, spirit gum eating away at the pigment of his very skin.
You do remember how to fire phasers.
His look changed more than any of the women on the show with that ponytail. Literally, the pigment of the skin of it. He's this gorgeous black actor, Michael Dorn, and the pigment around his nose where they glued the turtle onto his head was gradually eaten away over the years.
We appear to be caught in a temporal wake.
Captain, Earth.
The atmosphere contains high concentrations of methane, carbon monoxide, and fluorine.
See? I suspected as much. Oh.
Must have done it in the past. They went back and assimilated Earth. Changed history.
But if they changed history, why are we still here?
Temporal Wake must have somehow protected us from the changes in the timeline.
Answering all those important Star Trek questions before we get to the action.
Hold your course, Mr. Hawk.
Push in. Yes!
Whatever damage they've done.
Fabulous. I love this movie. Now we introduce Cromwell and Alfrey on Earth in another time. This was shot way up in the Angeles Crest Forest. Dreadful cold, middle of the night. I remember when we were planning this sequence, I said to Terry Frazee, who was a special effects guy who blows everything up, I said, Terry, would it be okay if we blew up one of the gardens of this house? He said, Frakes, you're doing a movie now. You can start to think big. Blow all the houses up. And from that moment on, he opened up my mind to what he said. He said, there's nothing you can't ask for. Think big. I thought, what great advice. Cromwell, brilliant in this role.
Z, you had enough. Huh? You're going up in that thing with a drunken pilot?
When I first came to Los Angeles, Alfre Woodard was one of the first people I met who was working with a dear friend of mine from Penn State who I'd gone to school with. And over a barbecue, she said, do you have a godmother? I said, no. Actually, I don't have a godmother. She said, you know what? I will be your godmother. So I have the privilege of having one of the world's greatest actresses as my godmother. And because of that relationship, I was able to ask her to be in this film. Great casting, actually, both of these actors. We're very lucky to get them both. This was the year that Cromwell, I think, was nominated for L.A. Confidential. And she had just come off the Academy Award nomination for Cross Creek. So to get them in a Star Trek movie was quite a coup. Here's what Terry Frazee was talking about. Think big. Blow everything up. Stuntmen flying, airbags. When you're making an episode of a TV show, you have to think, well, we don't have, you know, we have three squib shots, and maybe you can blow up a pile of dirt. But you're making a movie, you can think bigger.
Isotopes in the atmosphere, I would estimate we have arrived approximately 10 years after the Third World War.
Makes sense. Most of the major cities have been destroyed, very few governments left. 600 million dead. No resistance.
Captain.
Mr. Worf, quantum torpedoes.
Ready, sir.
Fire.
Fire. Yes. You like all that.
Fire at the surface. Location.
Western Hemisphere, North American continent. It's like a missile complex in central Montana.
Ah, yes. Let's go see what's down there. That reminds you of something, doesn't it, Picard?
Data. I need to know the exact date.
April 4th, 2063.
Oh, a long time ago in Star Trek lore. Yes! It's all coming together.
This must be where Zefram Cochrane is building his warp ship.
That's what they came here to do. Stop first contact.
How much damage, Lieutenant?
Can't tell. Get a load of this guy's eyes. Neil McDonough. He's got that white-blue.
Have a security team meet us in Transporter Room 3. Computer, mid-21st century civilian clothing.
Take him right in there. Go in there with him. Yeah. Now, these are some happy actors. First of all, on location, which rarely happened. Secondly, no spacesuit. Comfortable clothes. Two rarities on Star Trek. Gates gets to pull her hair up. People get to wear leathers and boots. And this location is in Phoenix, Arizona. It was a actual missile silo that we went in and obviously redecorated. But it was very eerie because the missiles were still in the silo, and it was a very hard place to shoot because you couldn't get any distance away from anything. But for instance, this is all real set. This is all there. It is. That's actually a real missile in a real missile silo with the camera way up on a crane.
missile appears to be intact. It damaged various sections.
And there's Alfrey, who never thought she'd see herself as an action hero or heroine. You show us, Data. And off he goes. Boom. That's a descender rig, as they say in the business, in which he's strapped in and the cameraman's strapped in, and they both descend together along the side of the missile silo. Gotta love Data. The ever-dry Brent Spiner. I think medical help.
Captain, this woman requires medical attention.
See? That's what I would have done. Thank God you've got the doctor with you. With her medical tricorder. Gates always big with the props. Look at her, see? Onto her second or third prop already. And he gets a shot as well. Anything to use the props. And she'll take one too. Great with props. You go, girl. Ah, the tried and true, the transporter effect. Another great set. They rebuild engineering for this film. Great highs and lows. The blue man, a Bullion, for all you Trekkers out there. Good to see a Bullion engineer. Look at that. Look at the scope of that set. As they say, when in doubt, shoot low and wide. Here's the descender rig in reverse, with the cameraman strapped into it, going right up between the actual silo and the wall of the missile. Good shot. Hopefully we don't see his reflection in the ship. Picard's sporting sort of a Australian duster type ensemble here. What a wonderful script. Brandon Braga and Ron Moore, who wrote a lot of the episodes and produced most of Next Generation, and then Ron went on to Deep Space Nine, and Brandon stayed on and did Voyager. We're a great writing team. Brandon Braga had a real gift for the fantasy. He was unafraid of fantasy. And Ron Moore was rooted in the mythology. He created a lot of the Klingon mythology and Vulcan mythology, and the meeting of the two minds, I think, was a perfect marriage for Star Trek.
Titanium casing, temperature variations in the fuel manifold. It is no more real.
We were so happy to be on location together, living in some shoddy hotel in Phoenix. I remember this so well because we never got to go out. Other movies live on location, and we'd spent 7 years together stuck on the Paramount lot. So just the simplicity of going one state away, staying at like a Holiday Inn and having, you know, chicken fried steak together at night was a treat.
That's true. And the future may die with him.
Beautiful visual effect, great shot. Always good to bring the Enterprise across at an angle. Oh, I would say it doesn't look good for these two, does it? You've seen enough Star Trek to know it does not look good for these two. What was that? Direct that right out of Ed Wood. One good shadow, and you got Ed Wood. Oh, don't come too close to the camera! There it is again, Ed Wood. Ed Wood and Jerry Goldsmith, of course. Yeah, exactly. Don't go in there! I could hear him screaming in the theater on Times Square. Okay, don't go in there! Oh, fatal flaw. That's good, isn't it? I love all that. Jerry Goldsmith, sound design, and good acting. And always push that camera in. See, he feels it. And faster and faster and faster and faster. We're very big on liquid nitrogen, as you can see right there. We've walked through more cold liquid nitrogen in the 15 years we've all been together.
Mr. Data and I are returning to the ship.
Understood.
Number one, take charge down here.
Aye, sir.
The damage to our cell membranes is repaired.
Aww. Dr. Crusher's trusted sidekick. Patty. Patty Yusakawa right over here on the left. And there's Dr. Death in the background. She got to keep all of her,
Come out of war. I need to know exactly what's been happening.
We just lost contact with Deck 16.
Moving point of view. Patrick walks into his own point of view. Tried and true technique. Great, rich, deep lighting in this stuff.
What were the exact environmental conditions in main engineering?
Atmospheric pressure was 2 kilopascals above normal, 92% humidity, 39.1 degrees Celsius.
39.1 degrees Celsius. Like a Borg ship.
Yes.
They knew their ship was doomed. Our shields were down. Somehow they transported over here without being detected. They'll assimilate the Enterprise, and then... Earth.
Always in good hands, these speeches with Patrick. Those 25 years in the Royal Shakespeare Company really paid off. And as he'll tell you, number one low comedy for many years. Lots of kings. Billie Jean King, B.B. King, The King, Elvis. We always had the, there we go, Data at warp speed. Patrick always had this wonderful idea that he'd do a one-man show called The Kings because he had played so many kings. And we always suggested that he should, in fact, play all those kings plus the ones I just mentioned. No, of course they won't. Here we go.
Wake up. You're all right. Come on. Come on. Wake up. Take it easy. Stay calm. You are all right. Now listen to me. Listen to me. You're going to be fine.
Alfrey's fabulous actress. Free. Fearless. And here's our nod to all things Star Trek. Bob Picardo from Voyager. Ba-doom, boom, boom. A throwback to Dr. McCoy. Picardo's a delightful actor.
Borg implants can cause severe skin irritations. Perhaps you'd like an analgesic cream?
Loaded with comedians, Star Trek is. This was one of the ideas that Rick and I thought hoped would work, was this crossover between our show and Voyager, which was on the air at the time that we were shooting Next Generation. And that was the opportunity, was to put Picardo in that scene with Gates to have the two doctors play with each other and refer to the third doctor, to the late, great DeForest Kelly. And it worked. If you look behind Picard, you'll see lots of stuntmen. See that? That's classic stuntman acting. Give me a gun. I'll establish myself in this scene. And then I'll earn my money as a stuntman later in the week. The stuntmen who really do well are the ones who can handle a line or two. Brent Spiner, the most unlikely man for gunplay, is great with a gun here.
If they encounter Enterprise crew members who've already been assimilated, don't hesitate to fire. Believe me, you'll be doing them a favor.
Something about this prop that was always a little more gutsy than that rather delicate phaser that we always had strapped conveniently to our waists when we needed it, of course, and never when we didn't. But that rifle was a throwback. Oh. My personal favorite scene in the film. Marina, absolutely brilliant. a deft, drunken touch, as you'll see. And Cromwell, great in this scene, too. Look at her.
Who is this jerk?
Riker very happy to be out of uniform here, too.
Will Riker? Zefram Cochrane.
Good bit here.
Good friend of yours?
Yes.
Husband?
No.
Good. Both of them wonderful. Tequila.
This is the good stuff.
Dr. Cochrane.
Yeah.
To the Phoenix.
We've been in this one shot for the whole beginning of the scene. No cuts yet. Look at this.
Nick, Nick, Nick.
Shameless. Broad and shameless. Boom. Breakaway glass.
I think we have to tell him the truth.
If we tell the truth, the timeline...
Timeline! This is no time to argue.
That's the first cut right there.
We don't have the time.
Wonderful actress. I love her.
What was I saying?
There we go.
You're drunk.
I am not.
Yes, you are.
Look, he wouldn't even talk to me unless I had a drink with him. And then it took 3 shots of something called tequila just to find out he was the one we're looking for. And I've spent the last 20 minutes trying to keep his hands off me. So don't go criticizing my counseling technique.
Sorry.
It's a primitive culture. I'm just trying to blend in.
You're blended, all right.
I already told him our cover story. He didn't believe me.
We are running out of time. Now, if we tell him the truth, do you think he'll be able to handle it?
If you're looking for my professional opinion as ship's counselor, he's nuts.
I'll be sure to note that.
Cromwell. Watch this. Yeah! Sets up the end of the movie. Oy, gewalt. What have I gotten myself into? Shake it, but don't break it, James. There you go. I love that scene. So non-Star Trek and yet so fun. Meanwhile, back at the smoke-filled Enterprise, we always seem to have not only liquid nitrogen, but this hanging atmosphere that OSHA, who is the company that always tells us what's safe and what's not safe, from ladders to toxic chemicals. As actors, we used to complain. We say, we can't work in this smoke. And the OSHA would come and allegedly test the smoke and tell us at the end of the test on a printed piece of paper, no, this is the safe smoke that you're allowed to work in. But it's part of the package. Everybody likes holding those big guns. Now the ship has been Borgified. Wonderful use of the sets that everyone recognizes and yet transformed just enough so that you can feel that the villain's there without seeing him.
It is an intriguing sensation. The most distracting, I'm sure it's a
Patrick always happy to have as many clothes off as he could, you'll find. He's got these great guns, his gun and his arms. So you notice everybody else is suited up. Patrick's got his guns out. He used to be a boxer. He used to train as a boxer. Back in his days between Yorkshire and London. He also used to write obituaries for his local newspaper. Little known fact that you only get here on the DVD.
Are you all right?
Yes, but we have wounded here.
Lopez, get these people back to Deck 14.
There was a civilian, a woman from the 21st century. We got separated.
We will watch for her.
Worf, she has no idea what's going on. Try to find her.
The Borgified ship. How many ways to introduce the guns? Another shot right out of Ed Wood. There we go. Yeah. Michael Westmore and his genius crack. There's Borg vision. Borg vision, we used the 10 millimeter spherical lens whenever we felt we wanted to look through those weird Borg eyeballs. Hopefully we used it sparingly enough that it was a tasty effect. But back to Michael Westmore, who's a genius and has created probably our greatest villain on Star Trek in the Borg. Each of these actors has a little different twist on the makeup. They all feel like they're of a piece, but the shading and texturing and the implants are all a little different from actor to actor. And Westmore and his team have been assigned specific Borg to do each morning. And their makeup makes Dorne look like a glamour makeup. They have hours in the chair, first to get ready for work in the morning, and then another couple hours at the end of the night to have all the stuff peeled off with the spirit gum remover and gel. And it's easier to be a human on Star Trek. Oh, animatronic hand never worked as well as it should. These are great, though. You can see how much sound helps. Each of these servos has its own distinct sound, and as they uncoil from their caves or whatever we call these things that the Borg rejuice themselves in, sound design with this frantic music. Some of the cues that Jerry wrote were helped by his son, Joel Goldsmith, who is a composer in his own right. And all our regular, we had about 12 Borgs that were with us through the whole movie, and we used to call them by their, it was Louis Borg and Jim Borg and Sam Borg, and they did a sort of an a cappella doo-wop song that they had created because they had way too much time together locked in the makeup trailer. Maybe you can get that for the DVD.
Regroup on deck 15. Don't let them touch you!
Nope. See? Brent, never afraid to take a fall. Shoot. This is a good sequence. Who shot this? Roaming handheld? He gets Borgified. Ooh. Boy, there's a shot we lived with for a long time. Computer-generated spikes. How much does his skin change? Money. Those are the shots that they always put the dollar sign next to, like that one right there. Do you really want this shot, Frakes, they used to say? Do you really need this shot? We could get it down... People would always barter with visual effects shots.
You! How the hell did you...
Back off!
Calm down!
Shut up! Who are you?
My name is Jean-Luc Picard.
No! Who are you with? What faction?
I'm not a member of the Eastern Coalition. Listen,
Shut up! I don't care who you're with. Get me the hell out of here.
Great commitment on Alfrey's part to this role. She really feels as if she is lost. She has no idea that this is the 24th century. She committed to the premise that she's like us. She's from the 21st century. Ah, and here she comes. The Borg Queen. The beautiful and talented Alice Krieg. A wonderful South African actress who we searched and far and wide to find this character because she needed to be dangerous, she needed to be sexy, she needed to be mysterious. And Alice filled the bill on all counts.
Your efforts to break the encryption codes will not be successful.
nor will your attempts to assimilate me into your collective.
Brave words.
Yeah, you can tell from her first voice.
From thousands of species across thousands of worlds since long before you were created. But now, they are all born.
Before this, she was probably best known from Chariots of Fire. But since, she's become a real part of the Star Trek lore.
You are an imperfect being, created by an imperfect being. Finding your weakness is only a matter of time.
Great way to introduce a character with voice only. Oh, no!
Let me just make sure that I understand you correctly, Commander. A group of cybernetic creatures from the future have traveled back through time to enslave the human race, and you're here to stop them?
Another actor in whose hands exposition is okay. The best ones make it sound like it's all part of the dialogue.
There she is.
Here we go.
Beautiful. All right, take a look.
Well, well, well. What have we got here? I love a good peep show.
The penny drops. Yeah. Great costumes on Cromwell's character, too, on Zefram Cochrane.
It's your telescope.
That's our ship, the Enterprise.
It's beautiful up there in the forest. I repeat it because it's so much a part of the memory. We were so happy to be outside, to be off the ship, to be actually in nature, no matter how cold it was. I mean, behind the camera, the whole crew is bundled up drinking hot chocolate and coffee and hand warmers and feet warmers and space heaters. But it was still good to be outside. You also go into night shoots, which is a strange phenomenon that happens only in movie making and NASA and military. Your entire day is turned around. Your day starts as the sun sets. You work all night, and then obviously your day ends as the sun rises in the morning, because you, as opposed to the old cliche about losing light, you lose dark. So as the sun is going down, you're having hopefully your breakfast, and you're getting geared up for a day work, and that day work is from, you know, 6 o'clock at night till 6 o'clock the next morning. And the first night you run on adrenaline. And the second night, you're a little bit spaced out. And it's very hard for us as humans to get used to the idea of sleeping during the day. Because when you come home from work at 6 in the morning, the rest of your family and the rest of the world is on regular daytime schedule. So you have to find yourself a dark room. Most of us stayed in a hotel and put the blackout curtains in. And desperately tried to go to sleep so you get some sleep, because you again had to get back up and have breakfast at dinner time and go to work for the night. And by the time you get your body clock turned around, which takes a day or so, a couple of days, melatonin always helped, you're all of a sudden, you're like a vampire. You only work at night. And when it goes on for a couple of weeks, it's great. But a couple of days of night shooting just ruin you. Borg vision. Yeah. This is some additional footage that we did after the film was completed, because the tests showed that everyone liked all the Borg stuff in the picture. So what? Look at this. This is fabulous. Michael Westmore. That's a physical effect. That's glued into somebody's eye socket. But the Borg stuff tested so well that we decided to add more of it so that it would be more intimidating. We had some, because of the wonderful scheduling and directing of the film, we had some money left over.
But when they took Deck 11, they just stopped.
Bork have assimilated more than half the ship in a matter of hours. Why stop there? What is on deck 11?
Hydroponics, stellar cartography, deflector control, no vital system.
They would not have stopped there unless it gave them a tactical advantage. Return to your checkpoint. Send reports every 10 minutes.
Right, sir.
Something must have happened in sickbay. Where are Dr. Crusher and the others?
Why did you break the ceasefire?
We didn't attack you.
That's a horrible set to work in. The Jeffries tube, can you see that? You're crawling on metal grating that looks, that rips into your knees. The sound guys hate it. The camera guys hate it. The actors hate it. You got to put knee pads on and elbow pads on. And you pray that you get it in a few takes. Otherwise, you got to go back to the beginning of the tube and crawl towards the camera again. You always dreaded a scene in the Jeffries tube. But Alfrey was a newcomer, so we put her in the tube. Part of the initiation fee.
What is this?
What is it? It used to be a green screen, and now it's the Earth.
New Guinea? Solomons? Montana will be up soon, but you may want to hold your breath. It's a long way down. Now listen to me. I'm not your enemy, and I can get you home. But first, you must put that weapon down.
As it gets hotter and hotter on the ship, our costume designer and the wardrobe department who were covering all the actors needed to keep track of the timeline of the picture so that the actors would be sweatier and sweatier and their costumes would open more and more, or they would lose more and more pieces. Because the Borg, part of the mythology of the Borg is that they live in, as Patrick said, 39.1 degrees centigrade or something, whatever it is, so that the ship, that adds another element of tension to the movie. And it's another place where you can see departments working together. Makeup, hair, wardrobe, all hopefully on the same page about how far down the timeline, how long they've been in the heat, the different characters.
There's no glass.
Sorry about that.
I've never seen that kind of technology.
That's because it hasn't been invented yet.
What?
Wonderful, tasteful introduction of the love theme here between Picard and Alfrey's character.
Are you ready?
Here she comes.
Who are you?
I am the Borg.
That is a contradiction. The Borg have a collective...
Wonderful grammatic syntax. I am the Borg. Now here's the signature visual effect from the film.
The end. The one who is many.
Not only is it a great visual effect, because obviously she's going to attach to her own body, and it was very complicated design, but watch what she does here. Oh, she sells it as an actor. As those things unhinge, she makes you believe that she has actually re-entered her body with her spine. And it's a perfect example of how the actor can help the visual effects department with just the, by understanding what effect we are attempting to achieve and explaining to her and showing her, as we did on the storyboards and on the animatics and on the animatronics, here's what it should look like. She was able to sell the strange pain or satisfaction of being reconnected to her body in a way that made it one of the best shots in the picture, and certainly one of the signature shots from ILM.
To better myself.
We two are on a quest to better ourselves. Evolving toward a state of perfection.
Forgive me, but the Borg do not evolve. They conquer.
By assimilating other beings into our collective, we are bringing them closer.
It's interesting, when the movie came out, people, especially men, responded, assimilated, stimulated. They responded to her so viscerally and so physically, and always with this sort of semi-embarrassment that they were so turned on by this villainous, this Borg. I think she's absolutely brilliant in this part. More work by Michael Westmore, the skin stretched. And she went through hell to get into this wardrobe and hair and makeup. She, as you can see, her whole, she has a beautiful long head of hair that goes down to her waist. That's all tucked up in a cap, and then this latex laid over the top, and then on top of that, these weird implants. Brent had a ball with this stuff as well. Look at her eyes. She has silver contacts in that Leonetti popped light into them so that they would reflect back at us. Brent wears yellow contacts, obviously. But she never complained once. She must have been in, between makeup, hair, wardrobe, she must have been in prep for 4 hours in the morning before she came to work. An absolute trooper.
I try to get back whenever I can. Good. They haven't broken the encryption code yet.
It's funny, each actor has their own way to use these props that we've become so familiar with. Patrick uses his middle finger. I was always an index finger guy. I think LeVar was a multi-finger guy. Brent used to work at Lefty to tell us that Data could work. It was by. But it's one of those subtle things that when I rewatch things, you can see each actor has made his own choice about, and also sometimes pushes his favorite number on the keypad, or his phone number, or his birth date, or his wedding anniversary, you know. So you always have some reference to go back to for take two so that you can match what you've done. You have to make a choice about. It also helps make it specific that you're not just punching numbers, you're making a choice, and then when you cut the scene together, it will cut because you are going to the same key each time.
And the rest of humanity.
This is an odd oversight on my part. When we shot this walk and talk through the hallways with these two, before we saw the Borg, there was a scene with the two of them walking through the empty hallway. And to build the tension, obviously, you needed to see what they saw. And I was so intent on getting these two actors through that scene, I forgot to shoot their empty point of view. So I had to go back a day later and shoot a handheld point of view of the empty hall so that we could cut it in. A lesson for all of you directors out there. Always shoot what they see. Borg vision. Fabulous combination of set. See how the set feels as if it feeds us the Borg. Zimmerman and Deborah Everton and Westmore all working in collaboration, the best type of collaboration, where it all feels like it's of a piece, that the production design is of one. Ah. Oh. Yeah. Down to Union Station. Now another wink to all things Star Trek. Ethan Phillips from Voyager.
Strict dress code, so you boys don't leave right now.
I'm looking for Nikki the Nose.
Yeah, the Nose. Hasn't been here in months.
This was great fun. Down Union Station in downtown Los Angeles, which is this wonderful deco building. Patrick thrilled to be in a tux. Hundreds of dancing extras. So rare for Star Trek, again. Unexpected. And a wonderful band singer here. There she is. Obviously a song licensed by Paramount that we were able to use over and over again. Great sequences. Costumes, again, the contrast to the Borg and to the ship to go into another period was one of the things that made this film work. Look at Nikki the Nose. He lights matches off the bottom of his metal nose. Hillary Hayes.
This is not a good time.
It's never the time for us, is it, Dix? Always some excuse, some case you're working on.
I have to talk to Nikki. I'll see you later.
Okay, but watch your caboose and dump the broad.
Great little moment. is Ronnie. Ronnie Rondell on the left with a mustache is our stunt coordinator. There he is, making sure he gets on camera. See, he's one of the stuntmen that can actually pull it off. Ooh, Alfrey, please. Get a load of this GAT. Some German submachine gun. Don't forget we're in the holodeck.
There. I think you got him.
Yeah. She's seen it all now. This gun comes with its own keeper as well, as like having an animal on the set. It was this period German submachine gun that came with a period German submachine gun keeper and safety wrangler.
Memory chip. It will contain a record of all the instructions this Borg has been receiving from the collective.
All right. Jean-Luc, it's one of your uniforms.
Yes. This was Ensign Lynch.
Tough luck, huh?
Ooh. If you notice the Star Trek communicator that we all had on our costumes, which is the Star Trek emblem, had become Borgified, and that's, I had hundreds of those made up to give to the cast and crew as a...
Doctor?
Yeah?
Would you mind taking a look at this?
Yeah.
I tried to reconstruct the intermix chamber from what I remember in school. Tell me if I got it right.
Here we go. School? There's Dwight Schultz, probably best known as Mad Dog Murdoch from A-Team. But he went on to become one of the favorite Star Trek characters with Reginald Barclay, who first appeared here in First Contact and then went on to be... Actually, I directed him an episode of Voyager, he and Picardo. And he's carried on to be part of the family. Mad performance.
Yeah, Reg. Yeah, that's good. But you need to reinforce this copper tubing with a nanopolymer.
Yeah, of course you do.
Dr. Cochran, I know this sounds silly, but can I shake your hand? Thank you, Doctor. I can't tell you what an honor it is to work with you on this project. I never Reg. Imagined that.
Dwight Schultz, married to an actress named Wendy Fulton, who I was married to on a television show called Bare Essence, on which I first met my wife, Jeannie Francis. Now that's the kind of stuff you only get on this DVD.
Do they have to keep doing that?
It's just a little hero worship, Doc. Tell you the truth, I can't say I blame him. We all grew up hearing about what you did here, or what you're about to do. You know, I probably shouldn't even tell you this, but I went to Zephram Cochran High School.
Really?
You know, I wish I had a picture of this.
Cromwell had a great sense of ease for a man as big as he must be 6'6". He had a great physical ease and a great sort of... he was comfortable inside his body. He was comfortable with playing this character as a drunk, this sort of mythical Star Trek character who created warp speed. I think it made him, or made the character, more human and more attractive because of the way Cromwell tackled the part instead of playing it with this sort of straight-laced respect. It was played with a wonderful casualness.
Oh, League. I get it. That's pretty funny.
Excuse me.
Commander?
Captain.
Jean-Luc.
His reports of my assimilation are greatly exaggerated.
See, that's the kind of stuff that the kids may not get, but it brings a smile to the faces of the other fans.
The Borg control over half the ship. We have tried to restore power to the bridge and the weapon systems, but we have been unsuccessful.
You see, as it's gotten further down the line in terms of the story, the costumes have become further disheveled. The sweat in the armpits has gotten deeper. The lights have gotten darker. And you can feel the sense of demise of the ship, even in the parts of the ship that have not been Borgified, if you will. See, Gates, again with the gun, she loves a good prop.
The past to assimilate the future. Then we must destroy the deflector dish before they can activate the beacon.
We can't get to deflector control or to shuttlecraft. Mr. Worf.
Do you remember your zero... Ah! Something we're all looking forward to. The scene on the deflector dish.
What are you suggesting?
I think boy, there was some planning.
Hang on. There's a humanoid life sign up ahead. 511 meters.
Geordi vision, not to be confused with Borg vision.
Cochrane.
Mm-hmm.
It's him, all right.
Now, this whole sequence, this is the bane of every costume designer, director, actor's existence are these spacesuits. Every movie that has them has had the same problems. How do you design something so that you can still see the actor that's in it, still keep it believable that it is actually something that would work in an atmosphere where you can't breathe, not have it fog up, not have it become so unbearably hot that you have to stop every 3 or 4 minutes? And I'm not sure they've still, to this day and age, solved it. But God bless them. They did their best. There were fans built into the headpieces. There were neon lights built in so that the faces could be lit from inside.
How are you doing, Mr. Worf?
I didn't envy them, especially old Turtlehead. Not only did he have to get the turtle glued on in the morning, then he had to put this damn space helmet on. This set, the dish on the outside, is a good shot. Give you a scope of the Enterprise. It was built on the biggest stage at Paramount and was rigged with all kinds of wires for flying because we had all, as you'll see coming up, all kinds of stunts.
Tell me. Are you using a polymer-based neural relay to transmit the organic nerve impulses to the central processor of my positronic net?
There's a line only for Brent.
How do you solve the problem of increased signal degradation inherent to organosynthetic transmission?
Do you always talk this much?
You can see him sitting at home learning his lines. That's the kind of lines you've got to learn.
Why do you insist on utilizing...
It's like learning a foreign language.
Your android brain is capable of so much more.
Have you forgotten? I'm endeavoring to become more human.
Human? We used to be exactly like them. Flawed, weak, organic. But we evolved to include the synthetic. Now we use both to attain perfection. Your goal should be the same as ours.
Believing oneself to be perfect is often the sign of a delusional mind.
Small words. From a small being trying to attack what he doesn't understand.
I understand that you have no real interest in me. That your goal is to obtain the encryption codes for the Enterprise computer.
That is one of our goals. One of many. But in order to reach it, I'm willing to help you reach yours.
At Data, he's a clever android. Not afraid to take on all those stuntmen.
Ah!
Is it becoming clear to you yet? Look at yourself.
Look how she's painted into that suit. Poor thing. latex, rubber, spirit gum, glue, all comes together in a very sexy package, but...
You're becoming more human all the time, Data. Now you're learning how to lie.
I love the sound in the background, the bells, those deep bells that seem to be part of the Borg signature music. The sustain on the strings and the clanging of the bells, as if the metal from the ship had been moved to the orchestra.
Do it. Don't be tempted by flesh.
They're about to do classic scene. We tried desperately to get this kiss on the MTV Best Kisses of the Year for this year. And for some reason, they didn't make the list, but I happen to think it's very sexy and should have been the winner.
How long has it been since you've used them?
8 years. 7 months, 16 days, 4 minutes, 22.
Far too long.
An android and a Borg, and still somehow very sexy. Oh, back on the dish. This stuff was so incredibly tedious. The whole set, the whole soundstage was wrapped in green screen so that all these backgrounds could be put in. And then the set itself, which is that shot right there, was raised up off the ground so that we could, and on a gimbal so that it could be moved around. So to get onto the set, you had to climb ladders to get in. And then these poor guys had to put the spacesuits on, and the villains had to have the Borg suits on. So there were always, before any shot, it wasn't just going in and touching up the leading lady's lipstick. It was a whole spiel with the hair, makeup, wardrobe. The riggers had to come up. The stuntmen had to come up to make sure everybody was safe. It was just a lot more time preparing to shoot than actually shooting.
You still looking for the bathroom?
I'm not going back.
Jamie Cromwell was so physically fit that when we were up here in the woods, he always used to run in the morning before work. Always used to run back to where we had the table set up for lunch. He was a vegan. He ate very, very well, which is why he's so long and lean and healthy.
You told him about the statue?
Ba-dum-boom. One of the things that worked so well in the script that Ron and Brandon and Rick put together is that while it is an action-adventure movie, it's also a horror movie. And in a horror movie, to build the suspense is the greatest challenge. So you have to build and build and build to what you hope will be somewhat of a peak where people are shot, are caught short of breath or taken aback by a shot or somewhat scared. And then hopefully you drop in either a little bit of levity, as we just did there with a little moment of a smile or something light, so you can go back and then rebuild. And to their credit and to the actors' credit, these moments of, even if it's not full-on comedy, these moments of lightness let the air back out so that the tension can be, again, hopefully, rebuilt so you can start to build the crescendo again and tighten up people's guts and make them wince a little bit and make them hold their breath a little bit. Because you can't sustain it for an hour and a half or it doesn't work. So you have to find little mini arcs inside the script and these comic moments peppered through the movie were integral to rebuilding the tension. Yeah. Great use of the green screen. Now, I told you to look out for Hawk. Things do not look good for our man out here on the deck with Worf and Picard, because we know they're not going to die. Oh, those damn tubes kept breaking, those glass tubes. Inserts shot lately. Later. This was a day we had an insert unit shooting on this stage, and on the next stage, we were shooting the Borg corridors, and Peter Lauritsen, our post-production producer, was shooting the inserts. I was shooting the Borg on the other corridor, and I think we had a third camera crew working. And I was sitting at a bunch of monitors, and one was plugged into one stage, one was plugged into another stage, another was plugged into a third stage. Great sense of power, or delusion of power, I suppose. Louis Borg, I believe. Strange how after working with these guys so long, you used to recognize them in Borg costume and never when they came to work in their t-shirt and jeans in the morning. Oh, more liquid nitrogen, always a favorite on Star Trek. I think these actors did a good job giving you the sense that they have magnetized boots. The mini backleth. Oof. Oh, great. We used a one-armed actor for that scene. As you would. You can see the plexiglass on the front of these headpieces steaming up in some of these shots, which is the greatest fear.
Hawk!
It doesn't look good for Hawk at this point, does it? The theme, the Borg theme coming back to haunt us during this scene as well. With the hammering on the metal. The dissonance. Arrhythm. Atonal. Thakump. Thakump. Oh, Patrick. On a wire rig. On a crane. With a wire attached to his back, I think around his waist, both shoulders, and then thrown across the stage by the stuntmen from one end to the other. A real trooper. Then obviously all the wires removed in post-production. But not unlike the, what film where you see the people flying. Apollo 13 did a lot of this zero-G sort of thing. Flying by Foy. Obviously, later on in Crouching Tiger, there's a lot of use of that wire rig stuff where people would do spins and all the wires would be removed afterwards. Same thing with this Borg holding onto the side. Hawk has been Borgified. Yeah. Good reveal. Helmet and then a head. Never hit your captain. Feels a little like 2001, some of this. The colors and the tone and the reminder of the bone flipping in slow motion through space. So the final communication has been cut off. She knows it. What a surprise. Our heroes have saved the day. Yes, and the Enterprise theme comes back. Blow it up. Assimilate this. Very Schwarzenegger. What'd you say? Assimilate this. Another line that fans always ask Dorn to say. Mr. Dorn, give us a little bit of assimilate this. Now, there's a kind of trivia you only get here. Oh, the cockpit.
I got a four-alarm hangover, either from the whiskey or your laser beam. Or both. But I'm ready to make history.
Charge Commander Riker.
Riker here?
We're ready to open the launch door.
Go ahead.
Oh, these little sets. From the shuttlecraft to the cockpits of any of these shows. Were such, I mean, they look great because they were full of detail and intricacy, but they were such a pain in the butt to shoot in because you couldn't hide lights, couldn't get the camera in, the actors couldn't move around. Of course, there are worse fates, I suppose. New Berlin. Very Pennsylvania Dutch reading of New Berlin. New Berlin.
I don't know who writes your history books or where you get your information from, but you people got some pretty funny ideas about me. You all look at me as if I'm some kind of saint or visionary or something.
I don't think you're a saint, Doc. If you did have a vision. And now we're sitting in it.
Just like Gene Roddenberry.
What my vision is? Dollar signs. Money. I didn't
build it. Gene was, in fact, a visionary. If not a saint, inspired all of this. 30 years, Star Trek has made people think positively about the future, and all because of Gene's optimistic vision of what it would be like in the 23rd and the 24th century, where people would treat each other with respect. We should be so lucky.
I never met him. I can't imagine I ever will.
Someone once said, don't try to be a great man, just be a man, and let history make its own judgments.
It's rhetorical nonsense. Who said that?
You did, 10 years from now.
You can see that one coming a mile away.
They're on the move again. The Borg just overran 3 of our defense checkpoints. They've taken over Decks 5 and 6. They've adapted every modulation of our weapons. It's like
see, Patrick's down to his T-shirt now.
Finding another way to modify our weapons so they'll be more effective. In the meantime, tell your men to stand their ground.
Sir.
Fight hand to hand if they have to.
The bridge is darker.
Aye, sir.
Everything is moving.
Wait. Captain, our weapons are useless. We must activate the auto-destruct sequence and use the escape pods to evacuate the ship. Now!
Jean-Luc, if we destroy the ship, we destroy the Borg.
We're gonna stay and fight.
Sir, we have lost the Enterprise. We should not sacrifice...
We have not lost the Enterprise, Mr. Worf. We are not going to lose the Enterprise.
We're setting up one of the best acting scenes I've ever been privileged to be part of. Albeit beneath the camera, staring at the,
You're afraid.
Yeah.
You want to destroy the ship and run away, you coward.
Jean-Luc.
If you were any other man, yeah. I would kill you where you stand.
Get off my bridge.
So serious, and yet, as soon as you call cut, the two of them would be so silly. Wrestling on the floor, jumping on each other's backs. Only kept a straight face as long as it was needed, and sometimes not even that long. One of the things about our company that used to drive other directors absolutely crazy was that we were so loosey-goosey that we would we'd talk and kibitz and mess around right up until the director called action. Most actors and most companies... Here it is. This scene, which took a day or day and a half to shoot, between these two masterful actors, is one of my favorite memories ever as a director. First of all, my relationship with Alfre was so deep and loving, and my relationship with Patrick, who is one of my best friends, and the privilege of seeing these two work together, toe-to-toe, sparring, with a really, really solid, leveled, multi-leveled scene to play in a, you know, it's a two-hander in one room with two masterful actors, and in the middle of a big action-adventure picture. It's a real treat to watch. It was really a treat to be there and shoot it.
I'm such an idiot.
Yeah.
It's so simple. The Borg hurt you, and now you're going to hurt them back.
In my century, we don't succumb to revenge. We have a more evolved sensibility.
Bullshit! I saw the look on your face when you shot those Borg on the holodeck.
That's how we got the PG rating. Nothing to do with the violence, I'm sure.
Oh, come on, Captain. You're not the first man to get a thrill from murdering someone.
I see it all the time.
Get out!
Or what? You'll kill me? Like you killed Ensign Lynch?
There was no way to save him.
You didn't even try. Where was your evolved sensibility?
Yeah, go. Oh, hey. Still gives me chills.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt your little quest. Captain Ahab has to go hunt his whale.
Wonderful literary references always in Star Trek.
This is not about revenge.
Liar!
This is about saving the future of humanity!
Jean-Luc, blow up the damn ship!
No! No!
Yeah! Of course, that glass wouldn't break. Over and over and over and over again, we pounded on that glass for the insert for it to break. So the cutaway had to be made, obviously. Wonderful writing, wonderful acting.
And we fall back. They assimilate entire worlds.
And Jerry Goldsmith sneaking in underneath.
Not again. The line must be drawn here.
Here.
This far, no farther. I will make them pay for what they've done.
It's a great button here. You think the scene's over. The tone changes. The mood changes. And she gets the last word.
You broke your little ships.
Oh, lovely.
Around Ahab.
Yeah.
And he piled upon the whale's white hump the sum of all the rage and hate felt by his whole race.
Patrick, of course, went on to do Moby Dick for Hallmark. Art imitating life yet again.
What? Moby Dick?
Actually, I never read it.
Coy. So much going on in this scene.
Ahab spent years hunting the white whale that crippled him. The quest for vengeance.
And he's made his turn. And we go into Act 3.
In the end, it destroyed.
The decision's been made. She's convinced him. She's had an effect on him. And he on her. Wonderful, wonderful, layered, textured writing. And down to the weapons and the symbols. Great scene. I love that one.
Prepare to evacuate the Enterprise.
There you go. So the intercutting now between the story that's taking place down on Earth in a time 200, 300 years before the time of the Enterprise is great. From that moment through the end of the film, we cut back and forth in a more rapid pace. And it's a real challenge for the editor, challenge for the composer. It's a perfect example of what I was talking about earlier about having to build the tension, and now we go back and forth between the two worlds. Camera moves a little bit faster. Cutting becomes more frantic. So we've got Data's story still in turmoil. The Picard story has made a decision. And the inevitable, which is what the Zefram Cochrane story down on Earth is about to take place. So it's a...
Think they'll build another one?
Plenty of letters left in the alphabet. Mr. Worf. I regret some of the things I said to you earlier.
Some.
Very Worf reading.
I think you're the bravest man I've ever known.
Thank you, sir.
See you on Gravette Island.
It's so funny to see these two so seriously face-to-face and know how silly they are. I've seen Dorn in the bridge go up over the control panel, dive on Patrick, wrestle him to the floor. For 7 years on the show, he threatened and never, unfortunately, got to do it. He threatened to take a raw egg into work and crack it on Patrick's bald pate if only he had had the guts. Here come the Borg. Yeah.
Control to Phoenix. Final launch sequence checks are complete. Good luck.
Everybody ready to make some history?
Always am.
I think I forgot something.
What?
I don't know. It's probably nothing.
Begin ignition sequence. 20.
Great use of music 19, in here.
Now I remember.
18. What?
Where is
17,
it?
What?
16. We can't lift off without 16, it.
Jordy, we've got to abort. 14,
no! No, 13, wait, I found it!
12, 11, 10, 9, 8,
7, rock and roll.
6.
Yes! I begged him to put this song in here. A magic. There's a good visual effects shot. You really feel that that ship came out of the ground there. Magic carpet ride in a Star Trek movie.
We'll be fine. Prepare for extinct.
This set was on a vibrating gimbal, as you can see. So we had the set vibrating and the camera on a bungee so that the operator could vibrate the camera as well. And that combined with the sound effect gave you the sense that we were actually in trouble in this little cockpit. You can see it there. Unfortunately, it vibrated our voices as well, so I think we had to loop this whole sequence. Blue screen, the big blue marble. Big Blue Marble is a children's show that Rick Berman, the producer of all things Star Trek, was the producer on in New York that he won Emmys for before he ever came over to L.A. to do Star Trek. A little bit of more trivia.
To both of us.
You're not leaving, are you?
Lily, when I was held captive on the Borg ship, my crew risked everything to save me. There is someone still on this ship, and I owe him the same.
I like the chemistry with these two. Very unlikely. Somehow appropriate for Star Trek. Those are all the pods, everyone leaving the ship. part of the ship that the fans didn't know existed. Borgified engineering behind those doors. You could hear the whispers move into the sound design, a combination of music and practical elements, as well as layering of vocal whispers that have been tracked both forward and backward to give the atmosphere. This is one of the reasons that I think First Contact was as successful as any of the Star Trek movies, is that it stayed on the point of having the crew members, the regulars, the people that the fans of the show have come to know and identify with, Picard and Data in particular, at the core of the movie and at the denouement here. And at the resolve, that the loyalty and friendship between those characters is what the whole movie is built around. And when we miss the mark on Star Trek, it's when we lose that, when we don't depend on the loyalty and friendship that's between the characters and also between the actors, but more importantly, between the characters that the core audience of all things Star Trek identify with and come to look forward to. It was true of the original show with Kirk and Spock and Dr. McCoy. That triangle had a certain chemistry that the fans of the show came to look forward to on every episode, and they also look forward to in all the movies. That relationship, that sort of irony, sarcasm, all the things that actors love to play, was in that relationship. And the same thing was true on our Star Trek, that the android who had allegedly no human feelings ended up having more human feelings and was able to express feelings more clearly than any of the humans on the show. The captain of the ship who had given his life to fly the Enterprise at the expense of having a wife and family and children had the children who were all of us, who were the rest of the crew. Those characteristics and elements and relationships are at the core of the success of Star Trek. Not the visual effects, not the high-techness, not the design of the ships. All of that is wonderful and all of it supports it, but the success of all things Star Trek, I think, is based on this sense of character loyalty, honesty, and mutual respect. And it pays off in spades here at the end of this movie in particular.
Locutus. Data, you are free to go.
She got what she wanted. She got Locutus of Borg back.
I do not wish to go.
As you can see, I have already found an equal.
You see, Data's been assimilated and has become part human. And the makeup on him has been altered so that half of his face is flesh and half of it is still that Data gold. It was happened that on this very day was the day that we took the cast photos for First Contact, the photos that would be part of the press kit. And Brent, in his infinite wisdom, because we had to shoot him on the bridge. We went on the bridge, and he would only shoot the cast photos in profile so that he wouldn't give away that the movie was about him being Borgified or humanified. So if you notice on all the press shots of all of us on the bridge in costume, Brent is at 180 profile, full profile, which is the half of his face that was still Data, while on the other half, the off-camera half of his face was either Borg makeup or human makeup. Anecdotal, if nothing else.
Structural integrity is holding. Speed, 20,000 kilometers per second.
That was in the trailer for sure.
Relax, Doctor. I'm sure they're just here to give us a send-off.
I am bringing the external sensors online.
Again, the writing. The idea of playing this wonderful, adventurous, heroic scene against the horror movie scene of the Data and the Borg Queen. They cut together great so that you never get too tired of one or the other.
Approaching light speed!
We're at critical velocity!
Quantum torpedoes locked.
Destroy them. Watch your futures end.
Another grammatical and syntax question. Watch your futures end. Is it possessive? Is it plural? You be the judge.
Data! Resistance is futile.
The log line. More liquid nitrogen. Now Patrick down to his heroic best. All that boxing training pays off here. My mother was such a huge fan of Picard that when I first got on the series, the first time I went home to visit her, on the refrigerator in my kitchen that I grew up in was a bigger-than-life picture of Patrick Stewart. I shared that with him when I went back to work, and she's, of course, never lived it down. Yes, you like all this. Always a temptation to cut these scenes faster as you see them more and more when you're directing or editing or producing. And you have to resist the temptation because an audience generally is only going to see it once and needs a few seconds on each shot to let the shot register. As you become familiar with a shot when you're cutting a movie or cutting a TV show or cutting anything, the synapses in your brain give you all the information much faster because it's already in your brain as a memory. And it's a real pitfall and one to resist, that you need to remember that you're showing this to an audience for the first time and hopefully telling the story cleanly and clearly. And if you cut too fast, it's confusing. If you cut too slow, it's boring. But if you cut too fast, it's confusing. God, we destroyed more sets over the years. This is a great throwback to the opening when we introduced her and we saw her spinal cord with all of its nerve endings. We go back and revisit that and the finality with which Picard then can... Yeah. So he destroys the Borg and he destroys his own nemesis as well.
Captain. Data.
You all right? Here's the theme back. Things are going to be all right. These two always liked acting together as well. Very good friends, obviously, but also wonderful acting partnership. They played a lot of scenes over the years, and Patrick,
she was unique.
I think, always brought out the best in Brandy. It was like playing tennis. When you played a scene with an actor who was either more experienced or better or more leveled, your game went up. I know when I played with Patrick, I became a better actor. Brent and Patrick, both consummate, interested, funny actors, were able to layer scenes up because they played so many scenes together and they trusted each other so much that they always found stuff. And I think it'd be only fair to mention that as the director of this and other things that I've had the privilege to do with these two actors, I always look better because I took very often their suggestions. 80%, 90% of the time, their ideas would only make things better and enhance moments that were already there. And here's the stuff that makes the Trekkers happy, the introduction. For the first time into the lore of Star Trek, the Vulcans, who went on to give us Spock and the wonderful Vulcan Fox on Enterprise. The low-budget version of Close Encounters, all this. As we panned across these extras who were seeing First Contact for the first time, we discovered there was a little girl in the front who had the most sympathetic, present face that we cut to her a few times during the sequence, and she went on to become an actress and actually found a lot of work. But she, we take great credit. That's a nice moment. I love that one. The two of them from behind. And here's the theme we heard during the credits being revisited. Jerry Goldsmith, an absolute master, one of the top two or three composers in the world. May he rest in peace. It was a great privilege to work with him on two movies. Yeah. A favorite. Now, Cromwell and I and this other, in this moment in the middle of the night, decided that in lieu of returning the Vulcan symbol, that he would choose the human handshake. And I think it was, and Berman and I went off to the side to commit to it, but I think it ended up being a very, very appropriate decision and is much more touching and personal than had he been able to somehow respond as a Vulcan. And it was again, it's the advantage of having wonderful actors making wonderful suggestions and being open enough to incorporate them. You end up looking better.
Taking these first steps into a new frontier. I shall miss you, Lily.
Always a question whether that kiss should have been something more. It seems so sedate. And yet there was nothing from earlier in the movie to merit a romantic kiss, so it was left as it is. Tone, so important, so hard to... Here's a nice oneer. Bring him out, take him across the bridge, introduce all the other characters, choreography. There he is.
...for the 24th century. I suspect our future is there waiting for us.
Course laid in, sir.
Make it so.
Ah, the signature move, Jean-Luc Picard. Wonderful theme. And we revisit the jukebox and introduce the Vulcans to rock and roll. Again, use music effectively so that hopefully this music makes you smile. We pull back, we run the credits, bridge it into the Star Trek theme, and you leave with a smile on your face. First Contact. Oh, Jerry Fleck, first assistant director, died last year. Far too young. He was my first on both Star Trek movies and lots of the episodes. Majel Barrett, the computer voice, Gene Roddenberry's widow. Ronnie Rondell, one of the great stuntmen of all time, retired after this show. Oh, what fun. See, they're the Andy Borg, Gary Borg, Billy Borg, Tom Borg, Wayne Borg. I think Westmore was nominated as well. See, additional music by Joel Goldsmith. Oh, Bob Blackman. I worked with Blackman at Seattle Repertory Theater many years before. All these names bring back such memories because so many of them have been with us for so many years in different departments. But I won't get too sentimental, hopefully. It was my first movie. I'm very proud of it, and it's a wonderful, wonderful story that it was my job to not screw up. People still like it. Some sense of how many people it takes when you watch these credits go on for minutes. Particularly when you get down to the visual effects and they have to run them in two columns or three columns. Oh, it's very emotional to go back and look at all this. Very satisfying, though.